And let me ask you one question, that our eyes see the images or any scene in what spectrum? You must be all 12th graduate with physics and chemistry and mathematics. So let me test your skill on to the physics, that what is the visible spectrum? Visible spectrum which we see from our eyes, and what is the range of that? Pardon? This is basic, very basic thing. This is your visible spectrum. And what is the wavelength? I can't hear. From here somebody was saying something. Any guess? This is 0.4 to 0.7 micron. 0.4 is what? Violet. And 0.7 is? Right. So 0.4 to 0.7, human eyes are capable of viewing the things in this spectrum only. Otherwise this electromagnetic spectrum is from starting from 0 to in centimeter and meter also. But our eyes can see only in this wavelength. Right? And this is 0.4 to 0.7. Before 0.4, what is the spectrum being called? That is ultraviolet. Before violet, that is ultraviolet, and after that is infrared. Right? So in infrared, generally when we have high temperature body or the person or the any equipment or any instrument which is having the higher temperature, then that thing is more visible. If suppose very dark conditions are there, light is not there, then you can't see. But using the IR sensor, you can see that objects also. So that is the physics behind the images. And generally, can you anybody attempt to answer that why we need satellite? What are the applications of satellite?
Communication
is one. Very good. And
broadcasting,
like television and all those broadcasting information. Next, telephone, satellite-based communication, telephone. You have already said. You are saying image processing. Processing will come once you acquire the image. So imaging is also one of the very big example of satellite applications. And why the imaging from the satellite? Can anybody think? I can do imaging from on the earth only or from aerial platform. Why the need of satellite?
Any part of the world we can take image.
Yes. Any part of the world we can take the image. And that gives the strategic advantage. In terms of like that for earth surface based or aerial based imaging, you have to be in your political boundary of the country. You can't take the image from other country or any other area. Because if you go over there, then you will be down. I mean, you are violating the rules. So that is the best use of satellite-based imaging, that you can do the imaging of any country or any kind of country for your strategic advantage. And that is the thing which is going on in my laboratory, which is we DTRL, Defense Training Research Lab. We are in DRDO under Ministry of Defense, and being work for our tri-services, which requires the intelligence information of the neighboring countries from which we may perceive threats. Right? You perceive threats only from your neighbors. Immediate neighbors gives more threat. Right? So this is about the satellite imaging, and let me tell you that right now the best resolution of satellite images which is available is 0.4 meter. And when I say resolution, let me first ask you, when you have any image, then that image has certain characteristics, right? So what is the basic characteristics? Like in your phone you have your camera, you take images. So how you define the image of that camera? Pixels, right? And generally in your mobile, the camera now is coming from 5 megapixel to 20 megapixel, 24 megapixel. So what is the importance of pixel?
Clarity.
Or you can sample a very small area, or a very small area is represented by 1 pixel. As you increase the pixel, lesser area will be represented by the same pixel. So this is also true in our satellite images, and that resolution is known as spatial resolution. Spatial resolution is that when I am saying that 0.4 meter resolution, that means 40 centimeter by 40 centimeter of the Earth's surface is represented by 1 pixel of the satellite image, and that is the best resolution available in the world. And in our ISRO point of view, I can say right now the best resolution which is available is 0.8 meter. We are a bit lagging behind the latest technology which is available in the world. So this is about the spatial resolution. What is the other resolution of the satellite image? What would be the other resolution? Just now I told you spectral. When is spectral? So when we see, when we deploy any sensor onto a satellite, then you have the visible spectrum, that is one aspect. Then you can have thermal also, IR radiation, right? Then you can, in IR there are three categories, near IR, mid IR and far IR, right? So all three you can again imagine from the satellite. Then what are the other spectrum with which the imaging should be done?
Living things.
Pardon?
Identification of living things.
Can you speak quickly?
Identification of living things.
See, that is the application. I am talking about the spectrum. Have you heard about microwave? Microwave oven you have seen? What is that? That is also a sort of spectrum. Microwave works on the fundamental that it gives the radiation. And some tens of hundreds of centimeters, the wavelength of the microwave is, and since the size of the object is also of the similar size, then it keeps on heating. That's the basic fundamental behind microwave oven. And similarly, you can do imaging of Earth's surface with the microwave radiation. And the advantage of microwave radiation is that it is active imaging, while this UV, this visible and this IR based imaging, they are passive imaging. What is the difference between active and passive? In passive, the source of light is sun. You are not irradiating the object with your source. Sun is illuminating everything on the Earth's surface. while active, you have the source of image, like you do in the microwave or you do in based on the laser based imaging. Laser is also one of the source of light. So that is the example of active image. So the next resolution which I was talking about will be spectral resolution. And apart from this, there is another resolution called temporal resolution. Temporal means that at what frequency of interval you can do the imaging. Because when you have the visible or IR, generally you do this imaging during the daylight condition. And most of the time it is around 9:58 a.m. or 10 a.m. in the morning when the images of the satellite are being captured. It's not like that you can capture the image in the evening or in afternoon. Time is always fixed. Satellite is sun synchronous. Sun synchronous means that at 10 a.m. only, everywhere in its row path, the images will be captured. So suppose you are at Chennai over this Avadi area, and right now you have taken at 10 a.m. the images of this area. Now you want to again do the imaging of the same area, then you have to revisit that. Satellite has to be programmed, and that time duration from one acquisition to the other acquisition, that time lag is known as the temporal resolution. That after these many days or these many hours, you can go to the same location and do the imaging. So this is another example of resolution called temporal resolution. So why we need temporal resolution? I have to done the imaging of today, then let's say temporal resolution is 7 days. So after 7 days again I have done the imaging. What are the conclusion I can make based on the two images?
Comparison.
Change. That is change detection. That is one of the very big application of this temporal resolution, that you can perform the change detection over a area. In Google Earth also you might have seen that it shows the images year wise, like 2017, 16, 15, 14, and you see how the landforms has changed, how settlements has increased, or how the greenery portion has decreased. Those kinds of change detection you can perform on the Google Earth itself. So, and now I would like to highlight that there is always a trade-off. Trade-off in the terms of either you can have very good spectral resolution, or you can have very good spatial resolution, or you can have very good temporal resolution. That is the three dimensions, and you can have best of only two. Third, you have to compromise. Why it is so? Let me give you the example of spatial and spectral resolution. Right? Spatial resolution is that you can have the pixel represented by lesser area, and if you want to have the lesser area, then reflected energy should be more. And how you collect the reflected energy from the surface or from the object in camera? How you collect that? Speak a bit loud. How you collect that energy? Have you observed that camera? Or is image processing or related to image any subject you have been offered or been understood? No? Lens you have seen?
Yes.
And what is the specification of that lens? How you define that lens? Suppose you go to buy a lens from the market for your digital camera, then how you will define?
mm.
So starting mm and m and ending mm, or you can say number of x, 8x or 10x, that is the optical resolution or optical zoom, you ask about, right? So in over here also, when you have spatial resolution, then this spatial resolution is being determined by one band, that means all the energy you have collected onto the camera and represented on the one pixel. And if you divide that continuous energy into various small spectrum, then energy will be less. So if you increase the spectral resolution, then the collected energy will be less and your spatial resolution will suffer. So you, either you can have better spatial resolution or you can have better spectral resolution, right? But to overcome this problem, there are other techniques like called pen sharpening. So this spatial resolution, when you have only one band, that is known as, when you have one band of image, then how you will see that? You have finished everything in one band. So that image will be your panchromatic image or black and white. Black and white image will be your panchromatic image, and this multispectral will be colored image, right? So you can do the pen sharpening where you can do, you can fuse both multispectral as well as spatial resolution, multispectral as well as panchromatic image, and you can, you get the best of both the images. That means that you, the fused image will have better spectral resolution because it will be colored image, as well as it will have the better spatial resolution because it has been fused by both the images. Like recently you might have seen that there are cameras which have, there are mobile phones which have two lenses in the background, in the behind, I mean back side. One is panchromatic and another is multispectral, so that you will get the more clarity and more natural color, right? So this is about the raster data or the images which you capture from the satellite, or can capture it from the aerial platform also. Suppose for your inside the country, you want to perform any aerial survey, visualize the landforms, how it is changing, or you want to generate the landform. So based on the aerial survey also, you can create the image. Now, this is the raw image. And how you will go, like suppose I want to see the image of Avadi area, then how computer will know that which image has to be rendered? You have hundreds of thousands of images. How computer will come to know that Avadi area images of this this image is of Avadi area only? Pardon? Panning?
Latitude,
longitude. Or as in technical terms, we say that those images need to be geo-referenced. The reference should be geography, geography of that area, which is represented by latitude and longitude, right? And apart from the geo-referencing, which you have rightly figured it out, suppose you have, let me first tell you that how the geo-referencing is being done. First you have the raw images. How you will do the geo-referencing of that, those images? You have a square or rectangle of image. How you will do the geo-referencing? Just me. How you will assign the lat long to each and every pixel? Because Is it feasible to assign each and every pixel the latitude? Suppose you have a 1 megapixel camera and 1 million of pixels are there in an image. Is it feasible to assign each and every pixel the latitude? No. So how you will do that? You take ground control points. Ground control points are the points which are very prominent features in that image for which you can assign the latitude. Only those GCPs you assign the latitude and rest other will get interpolated. Right? And it is recommended that in an image those GCP should be well distributed. It should not be concentrated onto one area. Right? So if you have the distributed GCP, let's say minimum 4 are required, more GCP you have, better will be the georeferencing of that image. So you provide the ground control points onto the image and you do the georeferencing through the interpolation technique. And for interpolation you can have linear interpolation, you can have bicubic interpolation, other spline interpolation, so many interpolation techniques are there. I hope that these interpolation techniques you might be knowing through computer graphics. Have you studied computer graphics? So this linear, bicubic, spline, these things should have been taught. This is all, I mean, mathematical model which you use in your computer graphics also. So this is about the georeferencing part. And once you do the georeferencing, then since there is another term which I want to introduce is orthorectification. Orthorectification means that you have imaged the Earth's surface from a camera which is downward looking, perpendicular to the Earth's surface. When you have the perpendicular to the Earth's surface, then the center pixel will be perfect square, right? But other pixels will have some relief distortion. Relief means height distortion. The boundary pixels will have more height distortion. And to compensate that height distortion, you provide the geometry of that Earth surface in terms of height, and then this orthorectification process takes place. And the advantage of orthorectification is that each pixel is now represented by the same unit length, and you can have the accurate measurement in terms of line measurement, like road network you have on the images. So you can have the road length very accurately, as well as areas in terms of meter or square kilometer or square. So orthorectification is the essential step so that you can have the accurate measurement onto that raster image. So this is about the raster imagery which we have captured from the satellite or from the aerial platform. You have done the georeferencing, then you do the orthorectification. Once you have done this orthorectification, now this image is ready to be the input to my GIS, geographic information system, right? Second part is vector data, which I have told you that road network or river network or place name, city information. So for city planning, these vector data will be specific to the application, and GIS end application could be in healthcare, it could be in town planning, it could be in disaster management, it could be for defense, it could be for telecom industry, it could be for infrastructure, it could be for electrification. You name any particular GIS application is there, and the difference is raster imagery will be same, but thematic layers or these vector layers will be specific to the application. Right? So suppose you want to use GIS for municipal corporation, then what will be the vector layers? For municipal corporation, what will be the vector layers? Vector information. First is the house marking. because it needs the house inventory. Then road network and river is okay. Or nobody is speaking from the back. Everybody attentive. For municipal corporation or for town planning, what would be the layers?
Water.
Water tanks. Okay. Water tanks. Very good. Then you group the house in terms of mohalla or locality. You divide that into the locality. Then
colony
or locality, I have told. Then you have bondages. You can have road network, you can have bridge, you can have nala, you can have bridge over the nala which is carrying road network. You can have, you name anything which is visible based on the requirement of that particular application, and that has to be digitized. And GIS gives, this geographic information gives, information system gives one of the utility to mark these various vector features onto the image. Because image you have, so you see various kind of features onto the image and you mark them. And for marking those features, then this is a standard tool called digitization workflow. You do the digitization of various landforms or various vector features. And this is the digitization or spatial coordinate or the geometry of those features. But each feature will have the associated attributes, like road. Road has various attributes which has been associated with it. What could be those attributes? The properties of those, attributes means properties of property of that particular feature. So for example, if I say road, then what will be the attributes or properties of that?
Size
or width of the road that you specify in terms of number of lanes. How many number of lanes it has? 4 lanes, 6 lanes, 8 lanes. And
one way,
two way, exactly. Then construction type, whether it is cemented or concrete or it could kacha track, right? What would the others?
Where the road leads.
That will be the joining operation. That will not come in the item. When it has been fabricated, when it has come, date information, time stamping of that. And who has constructed, suppose from PWD, Public Works Department. So this could be one of the attributes. So based on the application, you decide the attributes of the vector features. And based on the application, you have various vector features which has been extracted from the images. And for extraction of these vector features from the images, there are three modes. Three modes I am saying. One is the manual way you extract through manual processing. Second is semi-automatic. Semi-automatic means computer gives you the suggestion that this is road network or this is railway track or this is river network or this is pondage, this is water body. So based on the computer analysis, based on this artificial intelligence, neural network, fuzzy network, we can extract these features in a semi-automatic manner or in fully automatic also. Lot of research is going on to extract these features in a fully automatic manner, but semi-automatic, it is already available in various operations.
Sir,
how we So, have you heard the madam question? She wanted to know that with the application of GIS, how you will extract the information from?
KCD.
So, I mean, if you have fog or if you have smoke, right? So, there are various techniques like you have the visible image, you have thermal image. If you use both images, you will have better perception and then you can extract. This is a technique which is available in lot of real-time surveillance camera, which have surveillance application which have both visible camera as well as thermal camera. Both the images are used and then you can do the examination. At sensor level you have to work. Solution is there. So you have got your images, you have got your vector data. Now what else? How you will manage that raster data and vector data, which is so bulky? Raster image will be very bulky. Like if you see your mobile phone camera, which is of 8 megapixel, then one image is of how much size? Have you ever seen? Kitna?
4 KB.
2 MB. 8 megapixel camera. 20. Has anyone checked it carefully?
17.
One by one, please, one by one. If you want to give answer, then stand up and then answer. Has anybody seen? Try to observe and develop this scientific attitude to investigate the things or to have inquisitiveness, then only you will learn. Otherwise, things will go like this only. So, I will tell you how to calculate. You have 8 megapixel camera. So, 8 million pixels are already there. Right? And 1 pixel is represented by how many bits? Stand up and then answer. It is creating confusion. Have anybody seen in computer that 1 pixel is represented by how many pixels in graphics card property? Try to investigate the things. Computer everybody has seen? Everybody know that it has graphics card, right? Have you ever tried to see the property of that graphics card? In desktop, integrated graphics card is there. In bus station, you have explicit graphics card. But graphics card has to be there to render that. In desktop, integrated graphics card or motherboard is there. Desktop integrated graphics card is already there on the bottom. So you may check back home to your computer that it gives you various options. I mean, 1 pixel can be represented in a best way by 32 bit. And this 32 bit has got the composition of RGBA, red, green, blue, and alpha. Alpha is transparency level. You can have the transparency of the particular pixel, right? And when I say 32 bit, that means 4 byte, and you have 8 megapixel camera, then what will be the size? The native resolution or without compression, the image will be of 8 megapixel multiplied by 4 byte, 32 megabytes. If you have that image in Native means that image has not gone into any kind of compression. Generally, whatever be the image which we see, they have got their inherent compression. What are the formats of image you have seen? Stand up, then answer. JPEG. JPEG is full form is joint picture expert group, right? And that is a very heavy compression is being applied over here. That's why the image size will be less. What is the image format which is available without any compression? Can anybody answer? You have heard about JPEG only or any other formats also? PNG, which is portable. GIF is there, PNG is there, and BMP. BMP is the native, I mean, without any compression. BMP is without any compression, bitmap. I mean, it's purely bitmap only. So, this is the basic fundamental behind the image size and resolution. I mean, try to challenge each and every aspect, whatever you are studying, then only you will learn, otherwise, you will mug up the things and then forget. You will mug up the things and then forget. This will happen if you follow the way you are right now following, I can say. Try to challenge. Because everything, whatever we are seeing, whatever we are studying, or whatever we will learn, everything has the scientific rationale. You all are engineers. You all are engineers, so try to challenge and try to understand the things with its scientific logic. Everything has. So this is about the image and its size and resolution. And then we have talked about the vector data. Vector data in terms of various themes based on the depending on the requirement of the application, right? Now since we have this bulky image, like 8 megapixel is this much, then you have, you want to map the entire India or let's say entire Tamil Nadu, then image size will be in terabytes. And then vector features, in small area you have hundreds and thousands of features, like if I go by locality wise, then hundreds of locality will be available or thousands of locality will be available in Chennai itself. Then since this raster data and vector data both you have seen, how you will manage that? MIS is the application part, but how you will manage that into the computer, how you will structure that?
Tables.
Table. Talk about more abstract level. Tables is the some component level.
Form tables, rows and columns.
That is component wise. Go further up.
Database.
Exactly. So you will manage everything now in database. So everything is now linking and interesting also, I hope. So database. And which database you have till now learned or heard of?
Relational
database, any example? Any example of database? SQL. SQL is language, not database. Structured query language. That is language to inquire the database. But any example of database which you have? Bank. That is application. Any database software you have heard or used? You are third year student, you might have used some database. Second year. But you have heard about Oracle?
Yes, sir.
What is Oracle? Oracle is the perfect example of relational database management system, where you have table and apply relation, then you do the query, you take backup, you take restoration, you have role, you can have privileges. So everything is there. Oracle is one example, and this is a very big company. All of you are computer science graduates going to be, so you might be aware of this much I can have. Any database software example from Microsoft? MySQL. MySQL is not from Microsoft. MySQL is again from Oracle. MS Access. MS Access is from Microsoft, which is the inbuilt component of MS Office. But this is the RDBMS, but not for the enterprise purpose. It is for small applications only. Otherwise, the Microsoft variant for RDBMS is SQL Server. If you have seen any Windows operating system for server with Windows Server, this MS SQL Server, by default it comes, you can install also. MS Access is for small applications, desktop applications. Also, it's the example of database but from Microsoft, but for smaller applications, not for the enterprise-wide applications. And somebody has said that MySQL, so MySQL is from Oracle. The difference between MySQL and Oracle is that Oracle is licensed product. You have to purchase it. On the other hand, MySQL is freeware. You can use it without any cost. You need not to purchase the license. So, right? This is the difference between freeware and licensed software. There is another category of software which is very dear to me. And Professor Raghavendra had introduced in my introduction has told about that also. Can anybody recollect?
Open source.
Not exactly open software, it is open source software. And the underlying definition or meaning of open source software is it should be freeware, right? Without any license. Then what is the difference between freeware and open source? It is available with source code, which you can use, reuse, you can modify, you can distribute as per your will. That's the main difference. In freeware, you won't get the source code. You will not have any control on the source code. You cannot improve that also. So, the example of any open source software database?
HQ.
SQ or DB2?
SQ.
SQLite, you are saying? SQLite is open source. Then the biggest example is Postgres SQL Server. Postgres, PostGRE SQL Server. This is the open source software being developed under the umbrella of OSGeo. OSGeo is Open Source Geospatial, which is the founding organization for the development of various open source software for GIS application, OSGeo, Open Source Geospatial, right? So for various GIS applications, this OSGeo Foundation has developed numerous open source software. The example is, one is GDAL, GDAL, which is Geospatial Data Abstraction Library, which is required to read, manipulate the images, satellite images or geospatial images. Then another is OGR. You can note down also if you want, GDAL, OGR. OGR is required for handling the vector data, again from OSGeo. Then you can have PostgreSQL server. And PostgreSQL is pure database, and the special component is being handled by PostGIS, which is the special extension for this RDBMS. Right? Then another software which is used extensively for database perspective is SQLite. SQLite is a very light database. All this PostgreSQL is in comparison to Oracle and SQL Server, but SQLite is very light database, represented by a single file. All database is in a single file structured, and you can use that. That is again open source software. Then in OSGeo Foundation, there are various GIS software, Geographic Information System software. Sorry. And the name of various GIS software are Quantum GIS, on which in my laboratory we are working on. Then another example of GIS is GVSync, Map Window, then GRAWS Grass. So many open source software, GIS softwares are available under the OSGeo umbrella. And why so many GIS softwares are being developed? What is the need? Need is that as per your comfort level, as per your proficiency level, because some people are proficient in Java, some are in C, some are in Python, some are in C hash. So based on the proficiency, I mean, people have developed various GIS software. So like GVSync is in Java, this Quantum GIS uses C++ and Python. Map Builder uses Visual Basic and Visual Basic.net. So and these GIS softwares are being developed. If you see the genesis, I mean origination of the GIS softwares, these GIS softwares has been developed by either various military organizations like USGS or US Army. GIS is developed by US Army itself, and later on they have made it open to the public with open source licensing, so that value addition can be done by the public. That's the very beautiful framework which has been adopted abroad. In India, it is lacking. Lot of projects, lot of research we are doing, but we are not making those research available to the public. Either your research should be such so beautiful, so good, so that you can have patent and it has the commercialization angle. Otherwise, if you do not have patent, it is not deemed commercializable, then you should think that your software or the technology should be open source, so that entire world will get benefited and your work will be carried forward and will be improved upon also. Right? That's the basic advantage behind open source software, that if you make your software open to the public, then the public will improve that. And you will get name and fame, right? And there are various open source software licensing schemes. Achha, how many of you install the software onto your computer? Can you raise the hand? Nobody has installed any software onto the computer? Huh? You install the software on computer or not?
Yes, sir.
Which software has been installed? Antivirus. Sorry? Have you you ever installed operating system?
Yes, sir.
Operating system, which operating system? Windows or Linux? Linux also somewhere installed. So when you install any software, do you follow all the steps? Yes or no? Or you blindly say yes, yes, yes and install? Try to challenge it. Try to read it. Each step. Then you will have holistic learning. Otherwise, learning will not be there. What are the steps in a standard software installation? Right. But once you install the software, then it will ask you your company name, your name, then where you want to install it. Right? And there is a lot of terms condition which you simply drag down, say yes, I accept and go ahead. This is not a good practice. You should try to read it. Because whatever it is saying, you are just accepting it. Try to read it. Try to have the comparative statement between various softwares of that particular domain and then find it out which is the most suitable for your requirement. Then only you should install it. Don't be the blind followers. Don't be the blind followers to everything. I mean, in my life I have made a rule, except the religious things, you should caution each and every. Religious beliefs should not be challenged. Otherwise, other things you should challenge. Develop your scientific temperament. Right?